What happened was a machine got built on Wall Street, a machine that used subprime loans as their fodder.
Right.
And once this machinery got going, nobody wanted to stop it, and in some ways, nobody could stop it. So a place like Merrill Lynch, you know, what happened the last year before Merrill Lynch realized it was in trouble is that the mortgage department, with these new people in charge of it, they couldn't sell the AAA securities anymore. Nobody wanted to buy them anymore. They were saturated.
Mm-hmm. So they didn't want to buy them because they didn't, because they had all of their capital allocated, or they didn't want to buy them because
some people didn't want to buy them anymore because they started to get nervous about them. AIG had stopped insuring them, which caused a lot of banks to stop buying them.
Why did AIG stop insuring them?
This is a great irony. AIG figured out there was a problem. AIG knew that
this
there was a problem.
But was this when Hank Greenberg was there or
no,
not?
No.
He was gone. Because some argue that if Hank Greenberg had seen that, he would have somehow recognized the risk and would have done something because he was an obsessive manager.
We will never know. Right. We will never know the answer to that. What is true is that AIG smoked out that there were problems with the securities that they were insuring quite early. They stopped insuring them, but what they didn't do was hedge their risk with counterparties. In other words, the risk they held, they just kept. They just kept, and
they hedged some of it with counterparties.
No, they did not.
None.
Not until it was way, way, way too late. No, they were very
asleep.
They were very asleep. And meanwhile, so Merrill Lynch,
because they were making money,
has this machine going. They don't want it to stop. So what Merrill Lynch does is they wind up putting all the AAAs on their own books. And they built an exposure that had been they built their exposure from $5 billion to close to $50 billion in the space of a year without any of the executives at Merrill Lynch, the top executives, actually realizing what was going on. That is astonishing.
So as all this risk exposure was growing, the people at the top, whether it was at Citigroup or Merrill Lynch or wherever, Morgan Stanley, wherever, did not know how much they were in for if something would go wrong. They had no idea of the exposure. And so, therefore, when they'd have these meetings, no one would say, we can't do this because do you guys understand what the risk we're taking? Nobody said that.
In many ways, the story of the crisis is the story of human nature. It's a mixture of self-delusion, venality, and corruption. Self-delusion, because people didn't want to see what could have been right in front of them. The other part of the story is this development on Wall Street of these risk management tools where top executives could look at this risk and say, oh, well, our risk management tools say there's no risk here. And the truth
is, why would the risk management tools say that?
Because the securities were rated AAA.
Oh, yeah, right.
And so, there's this great line in our book from a former physicist who was a risk manager saying that Wall Street is actually quantitatively illiterate, meaning that many people aren't capable of looking at the numbers under the number.
Right.
To see if this miracle that the risk management models are spitting out actually makes any sense.